presenters today, so to have an opportunity to discuss their presentation. My name is Andrei Rezaev. I'm a comparative sociology professor and chair of comparative sociology at St. Petersburg State University. Together with David Wicklem, sociology professor at the University of Connecticut and editor-in-chief of a course of comparative sociology, Braille, by the way, the top, one of the top highest journals, professional journals for comparative sociologists. We've organized a session under the auspices of RC, comparative sociology, and I'm very pleased that the president of RC 20 sitting at our session under the auspices of comparative sociology research stream. We organized a session that we titled Comparative Capitalism: The Trajectories of Social and Economic Change in the Former Soviet Union Countries After 1991. Definitely, when we applied and when we tried to organize this session, we wanted to escape words like collapse, demise, whatever. So just to be ideologically neutral, okay? So not to make it, because this session is for sociologists, for those who are doing social analytics rather than policy, pure policy, and to make any sense. So the overall objective definitely was to bring together those who are doing theoretical research that who are trying to, in their day-to-day life, working on the theoretical and methodological frames of understanding what has happened back 25 years ago, as well as to provide empirical evidences and empirical research data. So we have listed in our programs in a little bit, so I will take a couple of minutes of your attention just to make us to give us sort of a background and maybe some organizational details. Of course, we have five presenters as it is in the program. Unfortunately, academician of and director of Russian Institute of Sociology, Mikhail Goshkov, he got sick yesterday. That's unfortunately, yeah, Professor Norris wanted to debate with him, definitely, I'm sure. But the second course is here in the room, and I believe she will have an opportunity to talk, or at least to present, because we've got the handouts and the e-version of the presentation. So, we've got four presenters, really great presenters, and here it's a little bit, I believe it was my fault, I could manage and technically to do it, you know, that's here, my fault, I was not done something else. So the presenters that will give the papers, that's the following order. Professor Norris, Zenonis Norris will be Yuri Gagarin, he will be the number one. Then we will have Natalia Tribubova, Pavel Lisitsyn, and Hoffman Boy paper. Next one will be Papakostas, Apostolos Papakostas, Zhanna Kravchenko, and then Valentin Starikov, last paper. And then that means we will have 20 minutes, close to 20 minutes, 19.5 minutes, and then we will have 10 minutes for a Q&A session. But definitely, if you have questions or clarifications, you can raise it right after the presentation. So that's 5 minutes. And I will take the policy, like, you know, 1 minute before the end of the presentation, I will raise my, you know, just short former Soviet Union guy in the classroom to show everybody that you've got only 1 minute. That's exactly for the presenters. All righty? So, David, you want to say a word to someone? Shall we ring up the curtain?
I don't think I need to.
Okay, shall we ring up the curtain now? Professor Knox, the floor is yours.
So, thank you. Well, the aim of my presentation is cross-national and cross-temporal comparison of the economic growth performance, measured, of course, by standard measure, GDP per capita, of the Soviets and the former Soviet Union republics, and explore the causes of the variation in this performance. Explore. I will not test hypothesis, my focus will be on the identifying some problems for further research. My initial research questions are as follows. What is the post-independence group performance of the former Soviet republics in comparison with this famous pre-independence period, which is famously known as stagnation period, period of story. I will take the freedom, the keywords repeat in Russian. More specifically, which former Soviet Union republics improved their growth performance in comparison with this period of the story, and which failed to do it? And more specifically, which ones among them did accelerate, and which did not? Next, which of those former Soviet republics were successful in decreasing the distance separating them from the most advanced countries, and which failed to? And last question, what are causal factors explaining differences in this performance? I would like to provide some background for those research questions. The instruction was to connect this to the 25 years anniversary of dissolution of Soviet Union. And this is a big question, why Soviet Union dissolved. There are a lot of theories, hypotheses, but maybe most obvious cause was that the socio-economic system of Soviet Union, state socialism, did not deliver on its promise, and its promise was to catch up and overtake the United States. Everybody knows about this third program of the Communist Party Soviet Union, where the goal was advanced to build communism in 20 years. Curiously, this construction of communism was operational defined as catching up with the United States. Well, and it meant to increase national income by some 40% in 20 years. I would guess that the Soviet Union almost sure would not have dissolved if this promise to catch with the US would be fulfilled. Maybe not so already in the 80s, sufficient in 90s, but 2000s. But this is what I would say is the ultimate cause for the breakdown of the solution of Soviet Union. The approximate cause was the failure of Gorbachev's attempt to accelerate the economic development of Soviet Union. To recall, those reforms were driven by the perception of the Soviet economy as stagnating. After the attempt to accelerate the Soviet economy remaining in the framework of the planned economy failed, the belief spread that transition to markets will help to accelerate, which is a story. Well, at the same time, the belief among the population, both of metropolitan Soviet Republic, Russian Federation, and other republics spread that everybody among them will be to do better in terms of economic performance if they will become sovereign or independent states. Well, the belief that Russia is feeding exploitative brotherly non-Russian republics was maybe the most important reason why Russian people voted for Yeltsin in 1991. Importantly, broad populations of many non-Russian republics, they share this belief. The single but critical difference is they perceive the subordination to Russia is break or main impediment of the economic progress of the republic. So this happy, complementarity of beliefs in metropolitan Russia and other republics, the life after the divorce solution and the independence will be better. Helped very much for this very, not very, but relatively smooth and peaceful unbending for the divorce, especially for compliance process, which was is what happened in this way. So after 25 years passes since this divorce, well, there is time to pass. This is the independence, the restoration of capitalism, did brought the economic rules that the nationalists in the former Soviet republics was compromised in court. How many republics did won from the war? Who were the winners and who were the losers? How much the winners did won and how much losers lose? So such formulations and questions is to next step. I'm dividing former Soviet Union into four sets, using not one but two outcome variables. One outcome variable is post-divorce acceleration. Another is post-divorce catching up. Post-divorce acceleration means that your GDP per capita grew more after independence than before. When you are in the stagnation period, then you are divorce winner. If your GDP per capita grow less than before the divorce, then you are divorce loser. But next, you are catching up winner. If you did manage during this time of independent life to decrease the distance or leg separating you from the benchmark country, which one? Of course, United States. Let's take the lead from this third program of the pursuit of Communist Party. So what? How much? If you did manage to decrease distance behind America, you are in those 25 years, then you are divorce winner. If you did not decrease this lag, then you are divorce loser. So the problem is about data. Intertemporally comparable data, they are not you, but they are. Look, those data sources is famous Madison Project data set, but happily it provides the data about GDP per capita, comparable data about GDP per capita only for 1 year, 1973. So you are not free to choose the period which you are comparing. You can compare 1973, 70 years, and then 2010, because 2010 is where the time series ends in data series. There is no problem about this difference of 3 years. Remember, famous economist Yulinsky asked for 500 days. Maybe 500 days to deliver market reforms. Well, let's give 1,000 more days.
So
it gives 3 years. Of course, market reforms do not deliver fruits, of course. Importantly, there is another, and I think more informative source. This is published by United States Department of Agriculture Economic Research Service. It's called International Macroeconomic Data Set. It provides uninterrupted GDP data series for all Soviet republics from 1979 to 2040, allowing to compare periods which you are choosing in this data series. That's one of reasons, because I will mostly use this data, second data source, and use Madison only for controls. Periods of comparison, the problem is where to start this pre-independence period. There are disagreements among historians. Then the stagnation era started. Some say in 1973, you are in this oil shock. when all bonanza suddenly come to Soviet Union and Soviet leaders decided to shrug off and reduce economic reforms, but others say that the status of the nation is after the suppression of previous spring. Somewhere in 1969, it's okay. I did composition for both periods, and I have no time for specifics in data. Well, most important well, things about benchmarks. What benchmarks for catching up? Well, if you're using medicine project data, then you are asked to increase your GDP per capita by 31%, because this is how much the GDP per capita of United States did grow during this period. If you are using another source, well, the benchmark value is a bit bigger, 150% for the period 1990-2000 and 140% for the period 1990-2000. Well, you see that picture is not very overall Soviet average data, then there was no catching up progress, and in many cases there was catching up progress, especially it relates to largest Soviet Republic, Russian Federation. Russian Federation actually grew better during the stagnation period than after during the period of independence life, state life. Well, but those average numbers, they conceal large variation between Soviet republics, their growing performance, both during this Zastoy period, as well during this independence period. Roughly, you can, analytically, you can divide them in, those four sets, you get four combinations. Well, then, on the left side, you see full success cases. There are republics which was caught up and accelerated. Armenia, Azerbaijan, Belarus, Estonia, Kazakhstan, Latvia, Turkmenistan, and in right lower part, there are absolute losers which did not caught up and did not accelerate. Georgia, Kyrgyzstan, Russia, Tajikistan, Ukraine. And there are one curious case, Lithuania, which caught up but did not accelerate. How it could happen? Just because, GDP per capita growth rate during the stagnation period was large enough to maintain this catching up even after becoming independent state. Prompts to ask questions, was really this stagnation, during stagnation era? Well, if you take average values, then there is no significant difference in the growth rates of United States and Soviet Union. There are differences between some specific republics, but you take overall average rates. The only difference is that Soviet growth rates were stable. They did not fluctuate that much, some 2% growth in United States, and for United States there was huge fluctuation. In some years is significant negative growth. Well, so then what is the reason to speak about stagnation in stagnation era? GDP growth figures can be interpreted as a proof of stagnation. Well, if you assume that you are stagnating, if you are not growing faster than United States. This was how the leaders of Soviet Union perceived this situation. And they perceive the situation because they were, well, good communists. They still believed in socialism. It means they believed that socialism is superior economic system over capitalism. Therefore, those overall normal growth rates, well, were perceived as stagnation. Actually, the Soviet Union was one, a lot of countries in middle income trap. Most, a lot of countries in the world are in the middle of income trap, but they did not perceive it as stagnation because they did not have ideology of type which Soviet Union had. Well, then the final question poses: how to explain this difference between performance of Soviet Republic and accelerated in catching up? Well, of course, because we are speaking about comparative capitalism, first suspect is a type of post-communist capitalism. Well, I have no time for details. I just say that I would like to distinguish four variants of this post-communist capitalism: neoliberalism, political oligarchy, state capitalism, and state monopolist capitalism, which is specific to the economic system of Russia. Well, next, this endowment with easily marketable natural resources. Some former Soviet Republic had such resources, others no. Next, involved war. Was the intrastate civil or interstate war? Well, and, quoting former republics for those variables, we get data set and can perform qualitative comparative analysis. Well, each works conducting so-called Boolean minimization. Well, and something sensible we can do only for positive outcomes. The problem is that we cannot receive some sensible results for negative outcomes because most failures are in the first row, which is contradictory. Some cases from this combination did accelerate it and some others not. Another contradictory and therefore interesting combination is the role of Baltic states. Estonia, Latvia, they both accelerated and caught up. Lithuania caught up but did not accelerate because its growth was very good during Soviet time. So to get more interesting conclusion, we must solve two puzzles. One of them is to solve Lithuanian puzzle, means to explain the difference, causes of difference in performance between Baltic countries, and most importantly, we must solve Armenian enigma. Because, again to this first row, all countries which had this political oligarchy capitalism, which had no endowments in the World War, they were failures, except for me, which interestingly did not perform worse than is full Azerbaijan. They had almost identical growth rates for Soviet rates and its big enemy, because Azerbaijan has huge endowments, Armenia has nothing.
And you do not have time.
Of course. Well, thank you. We'll work on those enigmas in the future.
That's right.
It's really interesting. Slovenia and Adriatic, Lithuania. So those who are interested can get and go. This is really interesting. Theoretical framework.
So for more details, please.
Yeah, over there. But we need to go further, and I'm really pleased to to invite another presenter who will present a paper prepared that it's a work in the progress by an international you have time just to wait, and I will talk a bit. So this is the ongoing project of Tandem, the international research laboratory that we have established with distinguished professor from the United States, Peter Kiberstein, St. Petersburg State University. It's a tandem, transnationalism and migration studies, comparative and institutional research. And it's a year, just the lab is working for a year. And Natalia will give a presentation. Here we go. This is Hope McCoy from the United States, and Pavel Lisitsyn from Economic University in St. Petersburg.
I'm here today, but I will try to do my best to present you the results, the preliminary results of the research. So, good afternoon. It is really my great pleasure today to present you some reflections and some preliminary results on the research that we conducted on transnationalism as a special mode of migrants' integration, looking at comparative perspectives of the USA and Russia. And the field research of the that I will point into, it is a product, as Andrea Dalinchka said, of our laboratory conduct. Now it is an outline of the presentation. You can see it, and the presentation has two foci. The first foci is the comparative perspective on transnational migration in the US and Russia. It is the first topic. And the second topic is an evidence from the Russian field that was conducted recently, and our attempts to discuss and to analyze what we have thought about transnational migration. And I should say that what I will present today are only preliminary results and they need for the analysis and discussion. It is good to start with the basic definition of transnationalism. There are different. But the most common and the most basic is the situation of being here and there, of existing beyond national borders. Transnationalism, as we will see later, exists in different manifestations, from flows of money to special social networks and cultural patterns. Another thing is that transnationalism does not imply migration necessarily. We can study transnational phenomena that are not connected with migration. However, studies of transnational migrations are probably the most urgent and also the most popular field in the studies of transnational. Now let's turn to comparative perspective. Comparing Russian transnational migration to the US transnational migration, at the first glance, to be see basic similarities. Both flows are predominantly labor migration and predominantly labor low qualified migration. Both flows are connected with transmittances with money that migrants send to their families and relatives in the country of origin. And both are connected with racial and ethnic tensions and also with social inequality. So, like my macro sociological characteristics of these two labels, two flows, they are mostly similar. But through a more subtle analysis, we can see very important differences. Firstly, migration in America, what we will talk now today, the major flow is from Mexico, and it started about 1950s, though, as Dr. Smith pointed out, in 1980s, this flow became more long-term migration, when before it was short-term migration. While in Russia, to Russia, the main migration flows, they started in 1990s, and they are from countries of Central Asia, they are from Soviet republics. So 25 years before, this was one state, and these migration flows were like interstate. But now they are really international migration. Second difference is the politics and policies of how ethnic characteristics are framed. USA is famous for melting pot policy, while in Soviet Union, so-called people's friendship was spread. Both policies eventually failed, however, now they influence how ethnic and racial differences are perceived. And it is their third difference. The third difference is about vocabulary, how ethnic characteristics and divisions are called. In the US, it's more about racial characteristics, while in Russia, it's about nations and nationalities. The latter is about cultural specificity of specific ethnic groups, and the race is about more like general characteristics as whiteness. Though in Russia, it has some urgency too, but nations and nationalities are not important. And like the general conclusion from this scheme is that we are to expect some differences in how transnational migration works in West and Russia. To speak about transnationalism, there are a lot of manifestations of transnationalism in different directions of how it is started.